How important is the sun to you? In a lesson to King Amun, Asclepius describes what our sun is. Here is what he said: even so the Creator, that is to say the sun, ever links heaven to earth, sending his substance down from above, and raising up matter from below. He draws everything around himself and into himself, and from himself gives all to all, bestowing his light in abundance. For it is he whose beneficent powers not only pervade the heavens and the air, but reach down to the lowest depth in the earth and abyss of the sea. If there is a spiritual substance, then it is the body of the sun, which his light contains. The sun alone being near to himself in place and nature knows of what his substance is made and from where it flows. We cannot see him, but by systematic efforts we can understand him. The vision of the sun, however, does not involve effort, for the brilliance of his countenance shines throughout the entire cosmos, both above and below. Wearing the cosmos as a crown, he sits at the center. Like a skilled driver, he safely guides the chariot of the cosmos, binding the reins to himself, so that it does not run amok. His reins are life, soul, breath, immortality, and generation. He slackens the reins so that the chariot can run freely, but not too far from himself. In fact, it stays with him. In this way everything is created. The sun bestows on the immortals their everlasting life, and he nourishes the eternal regions of the cosmos with the ascending light sent forth from the side that faces heaven, with the descending light that illumines the entire hollow realm of water, earth, and air. He enlivens and sets in motion birth and death. The creatures in this region of the cosmos he remakes and reshapes in a cyclical movement, exchanging one for another, kind for kind, form for form. In so creating, he acts just as he does with the celestial bodies. Change is constant for all bodies, for immortals without dissolution, for mortals with dissolution. Thus the immortal differs from the mortal and the mortal from the immortal. Around him are many choirs of spiritual powers like many different armies. They dwell together, and are not far from the immortals. Assigned to the region of men, they oversee their affairs. They carry out the commands of the gods with tempests, hurricanes, whirlwinds, with volcanoes and earthquakes, avenging impiety with famine and wars. Every kind of creature is sustained and nourished by the Sunday. As the spiritual world embraces the physical and fills it out with every different kind of form, so the sun also embraces everything in the cosmos, raising up and strengthening all generations. And when they are spent and ebbing away, he receives them back. The choir of spirits, or rather choirs, are placed under the command of the sun, choirs because there are many different kinds of powers. They are set in formation under the stars, and are equal in number to them. Thus arrayed, they serve each of the stars. Some of these powers are good and some are evil by nature, that is to say in their activity. For the essence of a spiritual power is its activity. There are also some who are a mixture of good and evil. All these spirits have been given authority over affairs upon earth and over turbulence there. They cause a vanity of disorders both publicly in cities and among nations, but also in the life of individuals. For they shape our souls after themselves and arouse them by residing in our sinews, in our marrow, vems, and arteries, and even in our brain, penetrating as deep as our very entrails. The spirits who are set as attendants beneath each star according to what each birth merits, take possession of each one of us at the moment we are born and are given breath. Never stationary but turning about, they change places from moment to moment. Now when these spirits enter the two parts of the soul through the body, each agitates the soul according to its own activity. But the rational part of the soul stands free of the tyranny of these powers and remains fit to receive God. When by way of the sun that rational part in a body is illumined by a ray of light, the spiritual powers cease to affect them. For no spirit or God has any power against one ray from the Supreme God. But all other men are born and led, both soul and body, by the powers, whose activities they dearly love. It is their thinking which is misled and misleads, not the love. Thus the powers have control over all our affairs upon earth through the instruments of our bodies. This control Hermes called destiny. Thus the spiritual world depends upon God and the physical world on the spiritual, and through the spiritual and physical world the sun receives from God a flow of consciousness, that is of creative power. Around the sun are the eight spheres, who depend on it. First is the sphere of the fixed stars, then the six of the planets and the one that encircles the earth. The spiritual powers depend on the spheres, and men upon the spiritual powers. Thus all things and all men are dependent upon God. Wherefore the Father of all is God, the Creator is the Son, and the cosmos is the instrument of His creative power. His spiritual substance governs the heavens govern the gods, and the powers, which are appointed by the gods, govern men. This is the host of gods and powers. Through these instruments God by Himself creates all this, and all things partake of God. Since this is so, they are God. Therefore in creating all things, He creates Himself, and He can never cease to create, for He Himself never ceases to be. As God has no end, so His handiwork has neither beginning nor end. Scientists tell us our solar system is encased in what they call a Oort cloud, and that means we are surrounded by large rocks. I think that's what I see when I look at the fires of creation. Thoth said our Supreme God creates with fire and He dwells on a throne of fire. And that's why He is the God of light. I put up a few pictures. I hope they help you.